Hey there, welcome to Intercontinental Ballistic Math. My name is David, and I recently learned about a topic that wasn't in any of my college math books, and it just blew my mind. Now, I first heard of regular old mathematical induction from my sister Debbie, and when she taught it to me, it seemed like a superpower crossed with a magic trick. Suddenly, I could prove all sorts of things about integers. Sorry, my animator Nick thinks that I learned all my math when I was 3 years old in the year 1800. Okay, that's a little less inaccurate. Anyway, years later, when I took real analysis, I wished for something similar to induction, but on the reals. Now, everyone knows that's impossible, but just in the last few months, I learned that there is, in fact, such a thing as real induction. There have been a couple papers that explain the technique, but it remains mostly unknown, and there's a good chance that your analysis professor has never heard of this technique. But the cool thing is that it vastly simplifies the proofs of some classic theorems in real analysis. So first, we will very briefly recap the principle of induction on the natural numbers, and we'll show a quick proof of it. Then we will try to extend this concept to the reals, but we will fail, and then we'll patch it up. We'll even prove that the new patched up version works. Then we'll show how to prove a big result in real analysis in only a few lines using real induction. But wait, there is bonus material at the end, super exciting stuff. Perhaps even more exciting than that cricket match that Nick was in that went into triple overtime, which for my American viewers means that it went on for about 8 days. Yeah, see Nick, it's not so funny when I control the graphics, is it? Anyway, moving on. If you're watching this video, you probably already know about induction on the natural numbers, so I'll keep this recap really brief. And just to make the analogy to real numbers simpler, I'll stick with so-called strong induction. Let's say we want to show some property applies to all natural numbers. Then we first show that 1 has the property. Then we show that anytime the subset 1 through k has the property, so does k plus 1. Or to put it another way, assume we have some subset s of the natural numbers, and we know that 1 is an element of s. This is called the base case. And we can guarantee that anytime s includes the integers 1 through k, it also contains k plus 1. We call that the induction hypothesis. If all that is true, we know that S equals the entire set of natural numbers. To prove this, use the fact that the natural numbers are well-ordered, meaning that every non-empty subset has a least element. If S does not consist of all the natural numbers, then the set of exceptions must be non-empty, and we can look at the smallest exception. That exception can't be 1, since we already know that 1 is a member of S. Let's call the smallest exception K. Actually, let's call it k plus 1, and we know that the natural numbers 1 up to k are all in S. Then by the induction hypothesis, k plus 1 must also be in S, which is a contradiction. Now what if we try to use the same sort of reasoning on the reals? Suppose S is a subset of the closed interval from A to B. Mirroring the base case, we will assume that A is a member of S. Now how do we mimic the induction hypothesis from earlier? There's no next real number after X, but we could try this. Suppose we know that the interval from A to X is a subset of S. Then we will assume that this always implies that there is some positive delta, such that the interval from X to X plus delta is also a subset of S. In other words, if S contains a closed interval starting at A, then it can be extended a tiny bit. Is this sufficient to guarantee that S includes all of AB? I encourage you to give this some thought and see if you can find the problem here. Just to make it concrete, suppose we have a subset S of the closed interval from 0 to 10, and we know that S includes 0, and that any time it contains the interval from 0 up to x, there's necessarily some positive delta, such that S also includes the interval from x to x plus delta. Can you come up with a set S like this that does not include the entire interval from 0 to 10? Here's one possibility. Let S be the half-open interval that includes 0 but not 6. Now pick any element x of S, which is necessarily less than 6. So the interval from 0 to x is in S, and we can extend this interval by moving the right endpoint halfway from x to 6. In other words, let delta be 1/2 the distance from x to 6. Then the interval x to x plus delta is certainly contained in S, yet the number 6, or anything past it, is not in S. To patch things up, we actually need an extra hypothesis. We still need to prove the base case, that is that A is a member of S, and we still need to know that any closed interval from A to X can be extended by some amount delta. We can call that the extension property. But we need to add that any time we know that the half-open interval from A to X is a subset of S,
then X itself is also a member of S. We'll call that the closure property. And if all three are satisfied, we can conclude that S equals the entire interval. Here's the proof of our theorem. Just like in the proof of regular induction, assume that S does not include all the points we're interested in. So there's some set of exceptions we'll call big E. That is, big E consists of all those real numbers in our interval from A to B that are not in S. Those are the points colored red on our number line. Now, in the previous proof, we took the smallest exception and derived a contradiction from that. But with real numbers, we can't just take the smallest element of a set. We have to take the greatest lower bound, otherwise known as the infimum. Now, we are assuming that E is non-empty and is bounded below by A, so it's perfectly valid to take the infimum of E and call it big L. But we have two cases to consider. One possibility is that L is actually a member of E, that is, E contains its infimum. The other case is that L is not in E. In other words, E contains real numbers that are arbitrarily close to L, but not L itself. Let's tackle the case where L is not in E. In other words, it's an S, so it's one of the good points. That means that every number from A up to and including L is in our set S, and we can therefore use the extension property. This says that we can find some delta so that all the points from L to L plus delta are also in S. But that means that L plus delta is also a lower bound for the bad points, so L wasn't the greatest lower bound of E after all. So that gives us a contradiction, and we can move on to the other case. So now let's assume that L is a member of E. That means that L is one of the exceptions, so it's not an S, but everything to the left of it is an S. We know that L can't be equal to A. After all, our base case tells us that A is an S. But since everything from A up to but not including L is an S, we can use the closure property. This property tells us that S must also include L itself, which again is a contradiction since we are assuming that L is one of the exceptions. So this case is impossible as well, and that's the end of our proof. Now let's put real induction to use and prove a classic result from real analysis. We will prove that the output of a continuous function on a closed bounded interval is bounded. Notice that we really need both the closed and bounded condition. If the interval isn't closed, then just consider the function 1 over x defined on the open interval from 0 to 1. That's a continuous function on a bounded non-closed interval, and it has no upper bound. And if the interval is unbounded, then just take the function e to the x, and that is also unbounded above. But for the closed bounded interval from a to b, a continuous function must be bounded. Now the whole trick to using real induction is to define our set S correctly. In this case, it is pretty straightforward. We will just let S be the set of all numbers x between a and b, such that f is bounded on the closed interval from a to x. Our goal is to show that S is equal to the entire closed interval from a to b. The first step is to establish the base case. That is, we have to show A is a member of S. Well, A being a member of S just means that F is bounded on the interval from A to A, which it clearly is, since we're only applying F to a single value from the domain. So the base case is taken care of. Now let's show that S has the extension property. So we assume that all the numbers from A up to and including X are in S. In other words, it's bounded from A to X. And we have to show that this interval can be extended by some amount. Since X is an S, this means that F is bounded on the closed interval from A to X. So let's say the absolute value of F in that range is less than or equal to big M. Now we have to use the definition of continuity. It says that we can pick any positive epsilon, let's just pick epsilon equal to 1, and we can find some interval around X so that F doesn't get more than one unit away from whatever F of X is. So let's see where we stand. From A to X, F is bounded in magnitude by big M, and when we move from X to any point in that tiny interval, F doesn't increase or decrease by more than 1. Well, that means the magnitude of F on this tiny extension can't get any bigger than big M plus 1. You can show this rigorously with the triangle inequality, but I think this is pretty intuitive. Okay, so we've extended our interval a slight amount, and the function is still bounded on this bigger interval, even though it's a different bound, but that's okay. We've satisfied the extension property. To wrap up, we need to prove the closure property. So we assume that the half-open interval that includes A but not X is a subset of S, and we need to show that X is also a member of S. Now we have to be careful here. The fact that the half-open interval from A to X is a subset of S does not mean that F is bounded on that interval. It simply says that if you pick any T inside that half interval, then F is bounded on the interval from A to T. In this example, I just plotted 1 over X from negative 5 to 0, and I filled in the value 0 for X equals 0. This function really is bounded on all these closed intervals that don't include 0, even though it is not bounded on the half open interval from negative 5 to 0. Now, of course, this f is not continuous at x equals 0, so this gives us the hint that in our proof, we will have to use the property of continuity at the point x. Okay, back to our continuous function f. All the points to the left of x are in S. Now, what about x itself? Once again, we'll let epsilon equal 1, and there's some interval around x where f does not deviate from f of x by more than 1. Okay, let's take one of the points in the interval to the left of x, call it u. U is a member of S, so f is bounded in the closed interval from a to u. Let's call that bound big M again. Great. Now we know that f of x is within 1 unit of f of u, so we can say that f of x can't be bigger than m plus 1 in magnitude. And now we can reason that in the little interval around x, f can't exceed big M plus 2. Perfect. That's a bound for the function value on the closed interval from a to x. That means the closure property holds, and we're done with the proof. So we've proven that a continuous function on the closed interval from a to b must be bounded. But we can go further and prove a quick corollary called the extreme value theorem. This says that not only is f bounded, it actually achieves both its minimum and maximum values. Notice that this really isn't obvious. For instance, take the function 1 over x, where x is greater than or equal to 1. This is continuous and bounded. It achieves a maximum value of 1 at x equals 1, but it does not achieve a minimum value. It's bounded below by 0, and it gets arbitrarily close to 0, but it never achieves that value. We could also take the function arctan of x on the entire real line. This is bounded above and below by plus and minus pi over 2. In fact, pi over 2 is the least upper bound of f, and negative pi over 2 is the greatest lower bound, but neither value is actually achieved. Instead, the function gets arbitrarily close to both values. Okay, let's write out the proof to the extreme value theorem. We are assuming that f is continuous on the closed interval from a to b. We won't actually use real induction to prove this, but we will use the previous result. Actually, we'll use it twice. Let's show that f achieves a minimum value. The proof that it achieves a maximum value is nearly identical. The previous theorem says that the values of f are bounded above and below, so we will let little m be the greatest lower bound of f. So let's assume that f never actually takes on the value m, in which case it must get arbitrarily close to m. So now let's look at the function f minus m. By assumption, this is always strictly positive, and it gets arbitrarily close to 0. Great. That means that 1 over this function must be unbounded. But now we have a problem. The function f is continuous, so f minus m is also continuous. And we know that f minus m is never 0, so 1 over the quantity f minus m is also continuous. But the previous theorem tells us that this new continuous function must be bounded on our interval, which is a contradiction because we just said that it was unbounded. And that's the whole proof.
My old real analysis book proved the extreme value theorem in a much more complicated way. It involved compact sets, the Heine-Borel theorem, connectedness, and some other advanced concepts. Incidentally, their proof of the Heine-Borel theorem looks suspiciously like a real induction argument. Anyway, if you can only learn one proof of the extreme value theorem, which one should you learn? This easy one, or the standard argument that requires tons of extra machinery? I'd still say you should learn the standard argument. Those building blocks are very important for other things you will learn in real analysis. So why bother learning a different proof for the same theorem? Well, it's important to remember that mathematics isn't a collection of unrelated facts. It's really a complicated web of ideas, and the connections between them are what's interesting. If you have a different way of proving a well-known theorem, then you've effectively uncovered a new set of connections that people hadn't really noticed before. And it's those connections that make the new proof valuable.
Now, I promised some bonus material, so we will prove the intermediate value theorem. This is another one of those real analysis results that normally requires some heavy machinery to prove, but we can dispense with it quickly using real induction. Suppose we have a continuous function, again on the closed bounded interval a to b. Pick some real number that's between f of a and f of b, call it y, and our theorem tells us that our function takes on the value y at some point in that interval. To keep things simple, we'll assume that f of a is negative, f of b is positive, and the intermediate value that we want the function to take on is 0. You can always transform your function to fit these hypotheses. As I said before, the real trick for these arguments is to define s in a useful way. This is a little trickier than before, so feel free to pause the video and give it a try. Okay, here we go. We will let s consist of all the numbers x in our interval where f of x is negative, or there's a point between a and x where the function is 0. Now, if we show that S equals the entire interval, we're done, since that would mean that B is in the set. So either f of B is negative, which it isn't, or there's a root in our interval, and that's what we want. Let's bang out these three properties. Clearly, A is an S because f of A is negative, so the base case is satisfied. Next, suppose that the closed interval from A to X is a subset of S. We need to extend our interval slightly. Well, if f of X is negative, then we can use a continuity argument just like the earlier ones to find a small interval around X where a function is still negative. On the other hand, if f of X is not negative, then by the definition of S, there must be a root in the interval A to X. So obviously, if we extend our interval by any amount, it will still contain a root. Finally, the closure property. If the half-open interval from A to X is a subset of S, can we conclude that X itself is also a member of S? Let's break this into three cases. If f of X is negative, then X is definitely an S, again by S's definition. If f of X is zero, then there's our root, and therefore X is an S. And if X is positive, we use continuity again to put an interval around X where f is positive. Grab one of those points to the left of X, call it U. Since U is an S, and f of U is positive, there must be a root in the interval A to U, and therefore there's a root in the interval A to X. So we're done. And this concludes our presentation. This video is our submission to 3 Blue 1 Brown Summer of Math Exposition number 4 for the year 2025. We have a lot of other videos, so we hope you'll subscribe to Intercontinental Ballistic Math and check them out. And if you give this video a thumbs up, Nick and I will really appreciate it. Thanks for watching.